If you have lemons, make lemonade. I'm stuck in the morning traffic going nowhere. Great. All the more time to tape, you see? Turn this wretched situation in the world into a positive. I say, oh, it's so terrible. Great. All the more reason to practice. I use quote-unquote practice more, meaning fortify your intent. Fortify your intent. Fortify your clarity. All the more reason to fortify your clarity in that practice isn't needed. Practice is always used, in the way we're using the term, is to gain some sort of merit. Now, there is a practice. Fortifying our clarity liberates us from this false view. This false viewpoint, this arrogant, it's arrogant. Now, teachings. For me, it's very, very cut and dry. Jesus' teaching has the widest context. For me, it's the best. But this in no way indicates that the other teachings aren't superlative as well. They're all teachings I listen to are top echelon. Top echelon. The only difference is that Jesus' teachings have this extraordinarily wide context I haven't found anywhere else, which explain why are we in this absurdist belief system in the first place. And he points out we're trying to be greater than God. We're trying to change reality. And this is, for me, this is key. This is was ultimately the most important. The insights that Jesus gave me are the root, core insights which motivate me and have kept me going. So in no way do I dispense with those. Everything, all the teachings that I get, like for Radical Dzogchen, are put in the context of Jesus' teachings. The huge, wide context. Why are we self-deluded? We know we want to get free of that. Why are we there in the first place? And this is what only Jesus' teaching answers this. I've never seen it in any other teaching for reasons I cannot understand. That one's beyond me. At some point I'll have to, you know, that'll dawn upon me why. But Jesus is very adamant. Spirit, in its absolute freedom, decided to see if it could be greater than God. This is the root of our trouble. And out of this arose an absurdist belief system. And this is the belief system that all teachings are designed to liberate us from. By recognizing that there's nothing you can do with absurdity except to drop it, set it down. It doesn't go anywhere. Okay, it doesn't go anywhere. There's nothing to do with it. There's nothing to attain. There's no merit. There's nothing out of that. We concoct this notion of merit to keep us enmeshed in this absurdist belief system. And of course, bodies, this world, bodies, are all part of this concocted belief in attaining merit. Now, it is true that the absurdist belief system has done its very best to twist Jesus' teachings, and that's very true. So it's understandable that some of us would, some feel they need to go around that, right? That's fine. It's helpful. But you don't throw the baby out with the bathwater. Okay, so, you know, the absurdist misinterpretation of Jesus, you can let that go, but you don't let go of Jesus. That's just my standpoint, because he's been the root teacher as far as motivation and helpfulness. Then we don't throw it out. But trying to, you know, absorb the absurdity that the absurdity has tried to heap upon him because he was so threatening to the absurdist belief system. I don't believe anyone has threatened the absurdist belief system more than Jesus. I mean, absolutely devastated it in terms of pointing out the absurdity of it. So absurdity really wants to, he's number one on their list, has got to get rid of this guy. Got to get rid of him. So they're doing their very best to do that. But I'm having none of that. I have none of that. Mistakes are to be corrected. There's profound truth, even when the absurdity tries to get rid of it. It's just throwing mud on it. The gold is still there. The gold is still there. There's something about put all your sins on Jesus, that kind of thing. You know, you'd say, what is that? Well, the key to liberation is just put all troubles, all fixations, all stuckness, put it into a future life. All your sins, all your stuckness, all your absurdity. Say, I'll maintain an option for a future life where I experience all this stuckness and absurdity. But for the rest of this life, nothing but relaxed bliss. Okay, for the rest of this life, nothing but a relaxed bliss. And you just lift everything off yourself like that. Don't do anything about it. So I'll struggle with it. I'll struggle, and I'll entertain it in a future life. Maybe if I have the option to entertain it in a future life, I'm just giving myself that option. Out of my freedom, I'm absolutely free to do so. And so any disagreements, any power struggles, all this nonsense in the world, if I need to engage with that, if I feel like I want to engage, I'll do it in a future life, but no more with this life. And we say that Jesus lifting the burden of sins off of us, you know, the description of it. So there are, you know, profound truths to Christianity, profound truths. If we can get the mud off of them. But this in no way diminishes the profound truths of other traditions at all. In no way does it diminish them. And we're not contrasting them, or, you know, in a contrasty way of judgment. We're just pointing out that these different traditions do have absolutely profound truth. And there's no question that there's this absurdity is just targeting Jesus and Christianity like it was the, you know, like it was the worst thing ever. Got to get rid of it. But what absurdity's targeting is just its own absurdity. You know, it builds absurdity up, claims that Jesus is responsible, and then attacks it and says, oh, I've got to get rid of Jesus. Jesus is not responsible for the absurd misinterpretations. This is bound to arise. But when I appeal for help, it's to everyone, to all enlightened beings. All of those liberated from absurdity, I appeal, open appeal. Whoever, whatever help can be given, this is welcome. It's just one mind, one spiritual family. And I don't have any trouble with receiving help. But we go with spiritual intuition. I understand that in some teachings they say stick within our lineage. You know, this works best for you. That's understandable. I understand that when you get into something else, it doesn't quite resonate with you. you say, okay, this isn't quite, you know, I want to stick with this. That's very understandable. I've experienced that too. So you have to go, let's say I'm reading Longchenpa. How do we listen? And it's very simple. You don't listen as a man, you don't listen as a woman. You don't listen as a Buddhist or a Christian, or a Hindu, you don't listen as this or that. There's a secret to all of this, and it is very simple. You listen in the wow. You don't listen right brain, left brain, analytical, emotional. You don't listen with the heart. You don't listen with the mind. None of that. All those labels have been getting in the way. You simply listen in the wow of it. And you don't need to do anything more than that. And when we keep doing that and keep doing that, it produces tremendously deep progress, not superficial. It goes beyond the superficial. The problem is, as we remain on the superficial, absurdity demands this of us. It says, the other's too difficult. No, it's staying superficial, which is too difficult. Because it doesn't work. That's the definition of too difficult, right? The definition of too much trouble is you're doing something which will never work. Isn't that too much trouble to be bothered with? Spinning your wheels endlessly? That's too much trouble. So going into the depths beyond superficiality, that's liberation from too much trouble. And listening in the wow, experiencing in the wow, is how to do it. There are really no thoughts in the wow. So it's the only thought is just wow. This isn't superficial. It's like, this is beyond superficiality. Wow. This is immeasurable. Wow. This is indefinable, if that's a word. I don't know if it's undefinable, indefinable, indefinable. This cannot be defined. This is, wow. This is immeasurable. Wow. Incalculable. Wow. It cannot even be said to be the heart. Wow. Or the mind. Or wow. Or anything. Nothing I could say about it. Wow. Get into that, listen in that way. It's the continual willingness to go beyond the superficial, which is all important. All important. And it's the continual attempt to remain superficial and just manipulate the style of superficiality in clever, click, and quick ways, which keeps you bound to too much trouble because it doesn't work. What doesn't work is too much trouble. Now, going beyond the superficial releases us into the immeasurable, profound, and it's very humbling for our superficiality, right? We're no longer obsessed with superficial functioning, and so we may seem to others to be unsophisticated, because our definition of sophistication, whether it be material or spiritual sophistication, is facility with the superficial, with manipulating the superficial. Forms, styles, all those actions, this and that, rhetoric, spiritual, materialistic. It's all, you know, spiritual materialism is super, the superficial. And this is what's ruling the roost in this world right now. I call it the yoga girl plague. It's the worst plague ever. This attitude is everywhere. It's superficial. Again, we get fooled again. We continually, absurdity continually is absurd. What a surprise, that absurdity is absurd. Absurdity is never anything other than absurd. That's what it is. It cannot be transformed. All this transformational stuff is just horizontal manipulation of the superficial, of absurdity and contrast, meaningless contrast, absurdity contrasting with absurdity, black absurdity contrasting with white absurdity. And believing it's finding meaning there. Another way of looking at it, you say Jesus' teachings have great strength. And these other teachings, like Radical Dzogchen, also have great strength. And the teachings of the great, like Ananda Mayama, the presence teachings like that, have great strength. And Ramana Maharshi's great silence has great strength. So all these teachings have great strength, and they're complementary. They're complementary. They're not contrasty, they're complementary. When you go beneath the superficial, you find that they're complementary. Each one helps shed light on all, which leads to ultimate liberation, which is beyond any description. Cannot be actually accurately described. It's immeasurable. How can we describe freedom? Perfect freedom. How can we have an image of perfect freedom? We're so free, we're free to try and bind our freedom. That's how free we are. So so take a tip from a top-notch surfer boy. Catch a wave every Saturday, boy. But don't you treat it like a toy. They'll eat their words with a fork and spoon, and watch them, they'll hit the road and be surfing soon. And when they catch a wave, they'll be sitting on top of the world. That's right. Take a tip from a top-notch surfer boy, and every Saturday boy. I mean, they go surfing every Saturday. Well, a lot of the surfers, they go surfing every day. The ones that live at the beach, every day. That's how you get good, really good. You see these young guys out there just out surfing, and all the older guys, and you find out they live at the beach, and they're like out sometimes two or three times a day, out early in the morning, out in the afternoon. You know, they might go out in the late evening, you know, whatever. And it's just every day they're out two times a day. One or two times a day, every single day. Guess what? What's the secret to it all? Well, it's overall familiarity is the secret to it. To surfing, for instance. And paddling is really the secret. That's right. You get get these light young guys, but who get strong in paddling, and the boards are buoyant, and they can go like paddle twice as fast, which means they can catch a wave. They can sit out further. They can catch the wave further out. They can drop in because they're already going faster. They can drop in without trouble. And then they can paddle back out real fast and not get caught inside by the waves. I mean, paddling, having speed in paddling is an essential element of success in surfing. I didn't have that, which is why I had trouble. For some reason, I wasn't blessed with good paddling muscles. And I realized that was my problem. Now, when I started surfing every day, I was living right on the beach at UC Santa Barbara, I started getting pretty good. I started being able to surf well, catch the waves. But it was every day, went out every single day. And that is what made the difference. Before, I'd go out like once a month, or, you know, sometimes every 2 months, and just sporadically. You can't build up the muscles to paddle well and to surf well if you go out just sporadically. But by going every day, finally, I got to the point where I could just go out there, paddle out there, turn around, catch a wave and ride it, paddle back out, catch another wave, and it was just like, wow, okay, this is how it's done. So the spiritual path is similar. Managing our success on the spiritual path is the key. Just like paddling really is the key to surfing. You need your balance too and other stuff, but if you can't paddle, you're not going to be able to surf well. You're going to get beat up by the surf. It's going to beat you up really badly. I got beat up severely by the ocean. Just devastated. I couldn't quite, you know, here comes a big set. It's like surfing a shore break. Very crunchy waves. They close out on you. It's just, I mean, where they break, they're just going to just blast you. And it's, you know, it's big. And we're paddling out. It's like, uh-oh, here comes a wave. And we're just like paddling like crazy. And here I am, and I'm just don't quite, I'm feeling weak. I don't quite have the strength. And I'm not moving fast enough. And the other guys go, tuk, 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 dig it. They got to dig. I mean, you got to really dig into it, like all out. And they'll punch through the wave as it's breaking. They'll punch through the lip and get past it. And then they're out, you know, and see the next set of the wave, and they bump, dig, 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 and they get past that one. And then, they're outside now, and they're safe. Me, I wasn't able to punch through the lip of the wave, and the wave just completely breaks right on top of me. Kaboom. Lose the board, get swept in, you know, and then swimming, just devastated. And that happens over and over and over and over again, where the other ones, they never experienced that. They're able to punch through the lip, get over the sets, and get outside and then catch waves and ride them. And so they come in and say, I really had a great time. Me, I'm like lying on the beach, and I just about got killed out there. Just that little extra speed in paddling makes all the difference. In golf, for instance, putting your drive in a playable place, getting it down there, and it's playable, where it's in the rough, the fairway, stuff makes all the difference. If you hit a bad tee shot, you get in a bad place, then the hole can become extremely difficult. And then the golf, you just struggle and struggle and struggle. And at the end of the round of golf, you're just like beat up, humiliated, humiliated. So you have to have that edge. Whatever you're doing, you have to have that edge. There's always some edge to what you're doing, that you have to have it. So in the spiritual path, it's everyday practice that is the edge that you need. Without that edge, it's just going to be too difficult. And ultimately, like me, I kept trying to surf. Finally, I was in a situation I was able to. But boy, before that, I went through years and years and years and years of just getting absolutely beat up by the ocean. never had. I tried practicing the muscles, but it just is nothing like actually surfing every day. Because the motivation and the adrenaline is there. And you eventually you build up those muscles. Eventually you do. So you just have to tough it out every day. And you look back and you say, oh, yeah, that's the only way. Spiritual path, the only way is an everyday way. Just look at it like that. The only way is an everyday way. So take a tip from a top-notch surfer boy. Catch a wave, catch an everyday Saturday boy. But don't you treat it like a toy. Ooh. They'll eat their words with a fork and spoon, and watch them, they'll hit the road and be surfing soon. And when they catch a wave, they'll be sitting on top of the world. Ooh-wah, 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 ooh. I'm trying, not going to compete with the Beach Boys. Let them, give them the trophy right now. Right place at the right time. And, you know, singing every day, hitting it every day, working at it every day, you get the edge. I knew how to get the tone, the singing tone. And had the Wrecking Crew playing the background for us. I mean, it was a convergence. It was a convergence. You listen to other groups, and then you put on their vocals, and listen, just, and it sounds different. They had the great reverb chamber working for them, the Wrecking Crew, studio musicians. They had all the best Neumann mics. They had every last thing you could think of, you know, the convergence-wise, and the genius arranging, and the blending, and the, you know, their brothers or cousins or, you know, close, culturally close thing, and it just on and on and on and on and on. And just, the music still holds up. And I said, you're not going to hear anybody better than the Beach Boys, really. That overall vivacity, you know, of everything is just it's still holding up very strong. Back then, the tube, everything, magnetic tape, the way it was recorded, everything is just it's just this powerful, powerful sound. Can't really fake that very well these days. So have the edge. You have to have the edge. Convergence of positive trends. The convergence of positive trends. And this happens when you're an everyday boy, everyday girl on the spiritual path. You want convergence? You can get it by being an everyday spiritual surfer. Go out every day. And you build up the spiritual muscles, which is really managing your path, managing your success, managing your success. Your expectations get better and better and better and better and better. You have to manage that. It just changed expectations. Every day you have changed expectations. Where most of us just try to fixate our expectations and say, this is the way to happiness. I expect to remain absurd my whole life, but at least I have stability with that. You know, it's kind of like saying, I'm going to fixate on instability and that will be my stability. What's that? That's absurdity. If we fixate on instability, we're experiencing instability. And yet, we think the fixation on instability is our stability. Just consider that absurdity. And your mind will just say, wow. Yeah. How is it that we believe fixating on absurdity, and on instability, fixate on absurd instability, How do we think that we will be content with a great stability? We will experience happiness from that in terms of stability. How does instability get transmuted into stability by fixating on instability? By saying, this is what I really want. This is what I'm going to have. No, we'll have instability. When we choose instability, we get instability. What a concept. And yet we're saying, no, we're free to liberate cause from effect, liberate effect from cause. No, freedom is not the freedom to change reality. Freedom is the freedom to enjoy reality. Now, when you have the kind of experiences I'm having now, you know, big wave. This is big wave surfing. You better stay in shape. You don't go out in big waves if you're not in tip-top shape. It's crazy. So what did I do? I got up this morning, felt, I'm tired. Oh gosh. What did I do? Went out for a run. Grinded out a run. Didn't feel so great. But you know, I just said, okay. One step at a time here. It's not trying to go too fast. Be humble, right? I know cars are passing me. Everyone's, you know, but here I am just chugging along, kind of just, obviously I'm, you know, just grinded. Ugh. And yet you do it in traffic, people everywhere. I mean, they look at you. Who's this guy running in the morning? He looks like he's tired. You know, doesn't look like a lot of pep. You know, so, hey, right? You have to have this humility. The world will judge you as you're nothing. You're nothing. Because they're all engaged with superficial style. And so they seem superficially, they seem, you know, more sophisticated than you. They're all better posers, better actors, actresses. And here you are, you seem just like kind of a, you know, you're just nothing, you know, there's nothing there, nothing to see. You have to have humility to do that. It's not easy. You don't want to make a spectacle out of your humility either. You know, just lower your head and just get it done. And don't worry. Don't worry about it. I just don't try not to pay attention or worry, just whatever. I'm just getting through this and that's it. And don't draw attention. Try to go out at times and, you know, people are not really paying attention and I don't want to, you know, because you're struggling. It's difficult. You're putting yourself through everyday difficulty, every day changing the set of expectations, every day living, walking in the wow. So I'm having these amazing experiences. That changes my set of expectations, doesn't it? Of what can happen. See, if we fixate on failure, we think, oh, I can be happy because I won't be disturbed by something I don't expect. This is continuity fear, right? Continuity fear says, don't disturb me with something I don't expect. I don't want it. It scares me. So we live lives in a box and we try to cut out all miracles, all miraculousness, thinking that okay, well, yeah, that's my happiness. I won't have my continuity feathers, won't get ruffled. Don't want any breezes to ruffle our continuity feathers. And yet, this is what we must do. We must open the windows to that breeze and let the breeze blow through and clear out the stale air of fixation on failure and instability, believing that this is our happiness. And we say, oh, but I'm not going to live a happy life. Well, I will not lead a superficial life. That's for sure. Those who spin their wheels, they say, well, yeah, I've been spinning my wheels all my life, and I'm used to it. That's normal. So I feel adjusted to normality. We won't live that kind of life. Adjusted to the normality of failure and instability and spinning our wheels and getting nowhere and suffering from absurdity. We don't adjust to that normality. So take a tip from a top-notch surfer boy. I'm always trying to get that. Take some advice. So take some advice. I'm always looking for you know, better and better and better advice. And the best advice is every day. Work out every day. That's really the best advice. And manage your path. Get that edge. Got to have the edge. And superficiality is not the edge that you need. The wow is the edge. Got to keep staying in the wow. Being able to handle the wow. And yesterday's success in managing the path does give you that edge with the wow today. So if you're a big wave surfer, being able to paddle really fast and swim really great and be able, you know, be in great tip-top shape gives you the edge to get outside, get out there. And then, wow, I'm out here again today. Riding the big waves. And the confidence you have today is in part predicated on yesterday, that you did a solid, very solid yesterday. You feel very strong, very confident. And so you're able to get out there again today. Nothing beats everydayness. I mean, as far as the greatest technique, spiritual technique there is, the greatest technique of all is everyday effort. Unbeatable until you cannot come up with a better technique than that. So if you're doing this every day, walking in the wow, every day, you are doing the highest technique there is. It's a technique that can't fail. Cannot fail. It's the safe way, the unfailable way. So people say, you know, oh, well, what's your technique? What's your, that is the secret. That is the technique. It's the highest technique. And of course, those who are looking for other techniques, what are they looking for? Those are the ones that say, well, I can't do it every day. I'm too busy for that. And so I want, you know, something I could do, you know, maybe some once a month sort of thing, or once a week, some sort of technique I can do that'll give me the same results. I don't know of any such technique. So, well, you know, no, you're not helpful then. Well, I only give the best techniques out. It's the sure thing, sure thing. I don't want to give anything out that's not a sure thing. Every day practice, every day walking in the wow, every day is the sure technique, the safe, sure technique of success. That's how you do it. I don't know any other technique. If that one's not there, then forget it. Because you won't be able to manage your success. Whatever other techniques you want to use, you won't be able to manage the success of it. And then you're going to get, if you're going to fixate on some sort of sophistication, superficial sophistication. And that's what happens lifetime after lifetime after lifetime. That's what happens. And then we say, oh, well, what went wrong? Well, we weren't using the best technique. That's what went wrong. And we say, well, I can't do it every day. Every day? Who says that? Absurdity says that, right? Because absurdity says there's so many other things you need to do to gain merit, to evolve, to grow, to gain merit. So many other practices to gain merit. You don't want to just limit yourself to everyday practice. I mean, why not? You know, you got to like take some days off and enjoy absurdity. Got to enjoy absurdity. the merit of enjoying absurdity. Take some days off. How? What? Take some days off from right technique? Why would anyone want to do that? I've never taken a day off. Why would I want to do that? It's like, take a day off and lose my momentum, lose the edge, so I get crunched. That's what absurdity's telling you. Hey, that getting crushed by absurdity is the way. You can't get crushed by absurdity if you keep practicing every day. So absurdity is giving you its advice because it thinks that we have to make absurdity true. And the way to do that is to keep getting crushed by it. Keep getting devoured by it. So it says, how can I devour you if you keep putting that stick in my mouth and I can't shut my jaws? Come on, get the stick out of there. That's what absurdity's saying. I gotta eat you alive. How can I do that if you're practicing every day? That's absurd. Well, I'm not saying that absurdity should eat me alive. So it's not absurd to interfere with such an objective. It's not absurd at all. It's right technique. We don't want to get eaten alive by absurdity. But absurdity says, well, there's nothing else for me to do. Well, it says, well, good. Well, then we'll just set you down. We don't need you. But you can't do that because I'm an effect that's separate from a cause. You have no power to do that. So of course I have power to do that. I don't have any power to separate cause and effect. Absurdity thinks you're crazy because absurdity says, hey, what you're doing won't work. You're not empowering absurdity. See, absurdity thinks we think that cause and effect are separate now, and we need to empower the separate effect. Find a way to empower it. Or what we're really trying to do is trying to disempower cause, as if disempowering cause is empowering effect. Thank you, Jesus, for all this great teaching. Commute's not bad. The traffic's not so bad. The traffic has gotten lighter, noticeably lighter. It's amazing. After this whole new year, it's been lighter here. It just suddenly, as if 100,000 cars just disappeared. It's really inexplicable. Maybe everybody's carpooling, maybe all the buses, although I'm seeing much less those big buses also. There's one right there. Speak of the devil, there's one right there, a big white bus. This is the white one. It's big white one. Unmarked buses, you know, look like prison buses. It's unmarked. No markings. You can't, secret. have a cloudy morning here. Oh, there's another one. Yeah. They're still around. But everything has eased off a little bit here in terms of the driving and the intensity and the, you know, you reach a certain saturation point. And this is when people's nerves start getting frayed. Now, the traffic's lighter, it's not so severe. Everybody, the attitude is relaxed down a notch, actually. You can feel it. Which is great. Not as stressful. Now, I see the buses. Oh, there's a lot of them now, I see, on 101. I just saw three of them, one right after the other here. Big white buses. Are busing the tech people to their prison cells. There's another one. Double deckers, looks like. Yeah. Get in there and crunch the numbers. We must crunch numbers today. That's working at this superficial. So there's this massive, massive focus on the superficial here. And this is what gives those lazy ones, the absurdists, hope, false hope, false hope. So much false hope here in the world. It's a disease. It's a plague. It's the worst plague in history right now. We're going through the worst plague in history, and it hasn't hit. The most virulent part of this plague has not hit yet. You talk about like the Spanish influenza, for instance, and you look at plagues throughout history. It starts out, it's bad, then it kind of hangs back for like during the summertime or winter, whatever, it's not quite as bad, and then it comes back, you know, it comes in waves, and then there's a certain point when it peaks, and this is when it becomes really, really devastating. So we're actually in the worst plague in history. We're suffering the worst plague in history right now. I'm telling you, this is a truism. It's not just a metaphor. We really are. This planet is suffering the worst plague that has ever struck this planet. It's a plague of absurdity, of focused on the horizontal, which is superficial sophistication. This is a spiritual plague. Of delay, a plague of severe delay. There's nothing worse than a plague of delay. It's the worst. Jesus said, don't fear those that can kill the body. Fear those that can, quote unquote, kill the spirit, which means delay. Fear those, it should have read, fear that which can put us under severe delay, hook us into severe delay. This is the plague that this planet's suffering from. And we've gone through waves of it, actually, already. Very bad. I barely survived it. Sometimes I say I didn't survive it at times. I feel like I was dead, and I kept being resurrected. Grace kept resurrecting me from the dead, actually. Maybe I've resurrected from the dead many times already, because this plague is intended to knock us out. And it has not peaked yet. It has not peaked at all. We've gotten the tip of the iceberg of this plague. But what is coming soon, maybe within months, is it's going to start peaking, and we're going to get the real teeth of it. And of course, prophecy says it'll be the worst situation ever. That even the saints will be in danger of being knocked out, knocked into superficiality, dragged into superficiality, and lose their depth. You know, in other words, be dragged into a cycle of delay. We must say no to this. Just like I had this homeless man who gave out this very bad vibe, horrible vibe. And he wanted to cross the street in front of me. He was trying to be aggressive and like say, look, I can walk across the street, whatever I want to walk across the street. You just got to stop for me. And I said, no, you're going to wait for me. You're going to wait for me. I'm not going to let you stop me like this. I'm not going to be infected by this plague that you're infected by. I'll pass on by. Thank you very much. I pointed at him. I said, hey, you're stopping right there. But I'm justifiably concerned about having gone through the earlier phases of this plague and being just devastated by it, meaning losing touch with depth and being dragged into superficial sophistication. I know how terrible it is, how dangerous it is, and to realize that we haven't seen the worst of it by any stretch. No, we have not. We've certainly seen some waves of it, some horrible waves of it. Just one after the other, we're getting just beat to a pulp, like a massive set of waves coming in. We're trying to paddle outside, and we just get pounded by these waves. So, but I got to get outside of this, get free of this. That's well, the real big waves are coming in soon. Just like in the ocean, you can, if you have sophisticated buoys monitoring ocean swell, you can tell if big waves are coming in from way out in the ocean. The difference out there is it may be very small, but just a small rise in the level of the ocean and a swell length there that's almost imperceptible can mean a huge wave coming in to shore. So literally, we're able to pretty much tell, you know, is there a big swell coming in, and ultimately, You can tell if a big waves are coming. So same thing spiritually. You can tell if there's some really big waves coming in of superficial, horizontal sophistication, superficiality, absurdity. So I live in dread of this. Justifiable dread of this, having already been impacted. So I boycott so much. I don't want to be pulled into any. I don't want anything, any interest in the world that will pull me into that. Stay outside. Get way outside. The waves that are coming in are going to be breaking way outside. This is another thing of the huge sets. You think you're outside of the sets of the break where the waves are breaking. But when a really big set comes in, they end up like breaking on a reef even further out. And you go, what the heck? I thought I was outside. And no, I'm getting crushed by this huge set coming in. So you have to get way outside. Get out in the far kelp beds. So that these big sets don't crush you. So people might be looking at me and say, why are you paddling so far outside? That's ridiculous. You're not going to catch anything out there. Or you know what? Well, you don't need to be out that far. That's just eccentric. Well, when the really big waves come, they're not going to think it's so eccentric. They're going to say, wow, why wasn't I out there? Well, they're going to say, well, just lucky. No, not lucky. Well-informed. So people may wonder, why are you boycotting this? Why are you boycotting this? Why are you boycotting the world? Why are you boycotting the world? It's necessary. Necessary. The waves that are coming in now of absurdist superficiality, thinking that this horizontal, superficial sophistication is the way to be happy, that fixation on instability is the way to be happy. This is a very, very powerful kind of wave of attraction coming into the world. It's been building up. You know, we need to restructure the world. We need to restructure this. People will get caught up in this mania. Manias are to come. Severe manias of superficiality. So we call upon all the great Dakinis, the great angels. Call upon all the great angels. Call upon all the great bodhisattvas, all the great saints. We call upon all the liberated ones, those who have been liberated from absurdity and are dwelling in the merit-free perfection of all that is, which we call God. We call upon all of them to spare no effort, spare no miracle to help us sidestep this virulent plague that is coming. And we say this with the utmost intensity and seriousness. And we ask for immediate action on this. Full-on immediate action, miraculous action on this. We authorize miraculous action on this. Miraculous action really is just something that's beyond the set of our present expectations, really. In hindsight, we say, oh yeah, of course, that's very doable. Only absurdity would say it's not. So our absurdist-shaped expectations, when they get exceeded like this, we say, oh, you know, it's a miracle. It's a miracle. Okay, well, miracles are the business of the Holy Spirit. That's His business. And that is just simply saving us from delay. Absurdity thinks delay is reality. Absurdity claims that delay in absurdity is life, is reality. So of course it's going to say you can't collapse time, you can't collapse delay. You can't do that. That's reality. So it's absurd to collapse reality. So miracles must be absurd. You know, this is the problem with false premise. Is it can seem very logically consistent if you don't see the false premise there. And then we get confused and we get nervous and we get shaky. This is a plague. Very low tide right now. Wow. 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 All the sloughs are empty. There's no water in them. That's amazing. That's a very low tide. There are tides. Someone told me that these recently the high and low tides have been like the highest and lowest ever. Just amazingly extremes in high and low tides. Just huge extremes. I believe it. This is why some of these storms have wreaked such damage. That they came in, the tides were so high. And then also going and seeing the low tides. It's amazing how low the tides have been. When we were at Monterey Bay coastline. Super low tides there. Wow. You just walk out, walk out, walk out, walk out. It's like it revealed so much. Well, we know that before a tsunami comes, the tides drop, the ocean drops precipitously. But the tsunami, a huge wave. We have a tsunami of absurdity coming at us. So miracles are just something that at present is a little bit outside our set of expectations. But once we get through the wow and all that and get used to it, then it's just simply normal for us. Non-absurdist. It's just, miracles are just non-absurd. It's just non-absurdity making its presence felt. That's all. What's wrong with that? Well, absurdity protests. What else can absurdity do but protest that? A meaningless protest. It's a meaningless belief system. It's a belief system based on nothing. Completely meaningless. And all it can do is protest like, you've got to make meaninglessness meaningful. again, we're just imagining an imaginary mandate. It doesn't exist. That's what we're projecting that. And it comes back to us. It's reflected in the mirror as absurdity. And we think this absurdity, so, well, I don't know where that came from. It must be some, it's a new reality. You know, it's our own projection. Man, I'm gaining weight. That's bad. Gotta just go for water right now. I'm making sure that I feel strong enough, but I'm definitely, this week I've put on like 4 pounds. So, got to cut back on that. It's amazing. So again, we ask for all liberated ones to the Holy Spirit to bring the miracles now. Exceed our expectations as much, as fast as possible. And give us amazing confirmations and familiarities that we need to sidestep this wave till we get out far enough and sidestep this wave. The waves that are coming in, the waves of absurdity. Dangerous waves. Powerfully dangerous waves. So we will keep focusing on this intent. We must have our intent like a laser right now. Focus like a laser. Ask and ye shall receive. The asking needs to be single-minded, meaning a single intent. Not a double intent to sabotage the request and then sabotage request. No, single request, no sabotage. Full-on miracles now. And we'll just accept the wow of it. And that's all there is to it. You don't have to do anything more than that. Of course it's going to be a wow. Or exceeding the set of absurdist expectations. Continuity, fear come up, and it's a wow. Don't need anything, go any further than that. That is the practice. Everyday practice, everyday walking in the wow is the great technique. That is the highest technique. So we remain in the highest technique here. Experiencing the miraculous on a intensely consistent basis now, an accelerated basis now. Everything coming up roses for us. All invitations, all doors open to us now. Nothing standing in our way, no obstructions whatsoever. Hallelujah. All right, as we continue here with our great intensity, everyday intensity is the secret technique. It is the high. It is the highest tantric technique, the highest secret technique, the highest esoteric, the highest. This is the everyday intensity is the great key, the great secret. There's any other. We have it here, and so we're talkity talkity talk. Look at that lawn. It's a fake lawn. Okay, very nice. I was talking with someone about a lot of various little things, and we got into the idea of you know, money and wills and money who gets passed down. And I said, you know, I never received a penny from any of my relatives. In my whole life, I've never received a penny, not even one penny. Nothing. And he talks about how it's a very important, the legacy, the reason why people can have homes, they can function here, is if you don't have any money at all, when you get money passed on from your relatives, it makes a gigantic difference. I mean, they may leave you with, you know, $200,000, you know, down payment on this house, you know, this or that, whatever. You get their property, the stuff they had, their savings, they have put it, bequeath it in a will. I never received a penny, not even a penny. That's how much everybody loves me, I guess. They say, let's freeze this guy out. Okay. But I don't know if anyone else got a penny either. We just did not have money passed down at all. Put you under the gun. So I'm saying, you know, I don't have a penny, which is true. As far as any legacy or anything to rest on in my life, I don't have a penny, really. Nothing to really rest on. Nothing that I could say, okay, this is really going to help me. I'm going to be able to rely on this. No. But I realized, I said, wait a minute, not so fast. I said, I don't have a penny, but I do have a ticket out of here. And I wouldn't sell that ticket for all the money in the world. That ticket is more valuable than all the power and goods and money in this world. You could not stack up everything in this world and say, here, you can have it. And I'll say, no way. Are you kidding me? This doesn't even begin to be a price for this ticket. This ticket is priceless. So I have this one thing I have is this priceless ticket out of this world. So I'm not going to sell that, but the problem is coming up, these intense waves of absurdity may fool us to such an extent we decide to give up this ticket and sell it. See, what can I get for this ticket? You know, this is the danger. Better exercise the option on this ticket right now. Or else we won't be able to see the value of it. We'll forget the value of it. We'll get an absurdist viewpoint on value, which is what absurdity does. It gives us a completely absurd perspective on value. It claims this world here is valuable. Bodies are valuable. All this has value. This is absurd. Has no value. Straight from Jesus. This world has no value whatsoever. And of course, the absurdity claims, what are you talking about, Jesus? You made this world. You're the God of this world. God, what do you mean? This is your world. You love this world. It's got so much value to it. He says, no. Yes, collectively, we have imagined this world to pursue an absurdist objective. That doesn't mean it has value to us. Not at all. What this world represents is no value, and we're trying to value no value and get value out of that. It's like we're valuing time, and time doesn't exist. So how can it have value? How can nothing have value? How can nothing at all have value? How can what doesn't exist, time doesn't exist at all? How can we claim it has value? How could that be meaningful? How could it not be just absurdity? Wow, just this plane just went directly overhead, just took off, this powerful prop plane, low, right over me, right then, just took off. Perfect world. Ticket to a perfect world. Why would I, you know, sell that? Why would I barter, sell that? That the world's constantly trying to get you to devaluate that. And this is trouble. So again, when you talk about intensity of calling upon help, you have something that is truly valuable like this. You got to call on help to secure the value of that in my mind. Super important. Now, the invitation from Jesus to visit this home, that is the ticket. Because when he invites you, that means he's got to find a way to get you there. You don't have to worry about it. I'm not worried about that. It would be absurd to invite you to his home and have no way to get there. What kind of invitation would that be? It would be an absurd invitation. letting up on our intensity now is just not an option. And yet this is what the world is insisting upon. And that leads to devaluing the freedom from absurdity, to devaluing that in our minds. This is what is scary about this time. So we have every right, when we have something that is so valuable and someone is trying desperately to devaluate it, and sneakily and trickily and deceptively trying to convince us to devalue it in our minds, which freedom from this world is of tremendous value to us, then we are within our rights, well within our rights, to ask for miraculous help. Help beyond something, anything we can imagine or expect. You know, something extraordinary. We're within our rights to call for extraordinary, all-out, special mission, miraculous mission help. To liberate us. It's like we're trapped. We're being held hostage. And a special forces come in and liberate us from our hostage situation. We talk about, you know, the U.S. has been through hostage crisis. Iranian, they held the hostages there, and back in the 70s and something like that. And you know, the times that the hostages are taken as a political tool. Well, we're being held hostage here in this world. And sometimes you need the special forces to come in because the negotiations just don't work. And of course, the hostage takers say, well, you got to explain to us how they're going to liberate you. And I say, well, you're going to find out. They're going to do it, and then you'll find out in hindsight. And maybe you won't even find out in a while because you don't want to admit to yourself it's possible. You just say it was blind, stupid luck, or incompetent, or, you know, whatever you want to say, it doesn't matter. You could say, you could draw any conclusions you want to draw. We'll deal with that in another life. But for this one right now, well, you know, we're count us as liberated. Count us as liberated. And questions about the liberation will have to wait to another lifetime. And we'll see what kind of questions you have then. Maybe, you know, in hindsight, you might say, you know, I'm kind of glad that it worked out that way. Or, you know, we'll see. But right now, no, we're not entertaining any questions how we got free. You know, well, we got free everyday effort, you know, is how we got free. There isn't any other everyday effort, which allows us to full stop in the wow, which allows us to entertain miracles, which is intervention beyond our expectations. Beyond the expectations of absurdity. Truth always exceeds the expectations of absurdity. So absurdity is always going to be nonplussed by it. How can you fix that? You got to drop absurdity. You can never have absurdity not be nonplussed by reality. It's not possible. Trying to teach that is impossibility. It's futile. So we must gradually let go of absurdity. And temporarily we have this jittery feeling when we do, so that we're not nonplussed by reality. We're not just completely, you know, discombobulated, shocked, like, oh, this is like this. I didn't expect this. This is too much. What's going on? I don't, you know. No, that absurdity will always be that way with reality. So we simply have to drop absurdity. And again, absurdity doesn't drop absurdity. Truth, which is what we are, freedom, which is what we are, has to drop trying to pretend that freedom doesn't exist, which is what absurdity really is. It's just, we're just pretending that our freedom doesn't exist. And again, people might read some Vajrayana Buddhist, you know, tantric techniques of visualization, this ball of light, and move this colored light up here, and the subtle energies here. You know, there's millions of these tantric exercises. And they might think, oh, yeah, okay, but I need a secret exercise. Do you know, did some lama tell you what it is? How about Longchenpa? Did he give you some insight? Oh, I got to know this. No, the big secret exercise is everyday intensity. That is it. Everything else is icing on the cake. You don't have the cake, what good is the icing going to do? You don't know how to manage your success, what good are these exercises going to do? What good is any exercise going to do if we're not really good at managing our success? And listening and practicing, whatever we do, it's in the wow, accepting the wow of it. This is not superficial. We've gone beneath the superficial here. That's the secret exercise. People say, oh yeah, but yeah, what? I don't know, you know, the sort of sophisticated kind of thing where I'm dealing with the bells and the whistles. And people will think I'm sophisticated. If I'm doing that, I'm doing this esoteric technique. Oh, really? Yes. Wow, I'm very sophisticated. So you're not like every day, doing it every day just in case. Yeah, and I only do it like it's once a month I do this exercise. It's just like, wow. It's just, it's super sophisticated esoteric exercise. Oh. Wow, that's great. Really sophisticated. Why are these others grinding away every day? Oh, well, they don't know this, secret technique. You know, that's why. If they just knew that, that'd be easy. Oh, interesting. No, we're just here. We're just a little old nose to the grindstone every day. Intensity, everyday intensity. Sitting in the cave of intensity. Sitting in the cave of intensity every day, as we're driving, as we're eating, as we're walking, as we're running, as we're working, at whatever we're doing, let everything reflect intensity of truth back to us, and keep us motivated. Let our motivation remain very high. Let our motivation be peaking now. Reaching ever higher levels of motivation and intensity. Let us paddle out, paddle out, paddle out. Get out farther, further, farther, farther, farther. So you don't get stuck in a breaking point. Let us value what is valuable and not value what has no value. And let us be able to make the distinction, which is all important. And of course, absurdity's goal is to make us so we feel we can't make the distinction. We're not able to. And we get frustrated and we give up. This is defense system. Jesus calls it the egoic defense system. Ah, interesting. There's a license plate. AZ213, AZ, Arizona. Arizona license plate. Arizona, a reduced intensity zone. See how I just use something that you just notice. What does it do? Wow. It triggers a focus, triggers a focus, triggers a focus. A reduced intensity zone, a reduced intensity zone. The Pure Lands, where absurdity doesn't rule the roost. Where absurdity can't put on a pair of trousers or a dress and say, look, I'm no longer absurd. I got a makeover. I'm no longer absurd. Absurdity. I'm now sophisticated. I'm now sophisticated. No more absurdity. Just put on a dress. Just got a new hairstyle. And the people here go, oh, what a relief. Finally, we're going to be happy. Finally, we're going to absurdity now. We can be content with it. Fixating on instability. Finally, it's going to satisfy us. Just all it needed was a little makeover. We can ask ourselves and others, what is the most valuable thing in this world? This is a great question to ask. What is the... This is for questions. Ask yourself this question. This would be an educational exercise. This is what teachers should be teaching at school. Kiddies, what is the most valuable thing in the world? I want you to do a report on that. What do you feel the most valuable thing in the world is? Do a report. And we kind of got, no one ever asked us this question in school. But similar things. What's really important? What's the most important thing to you, That's similar, okay? And you're supposed to write essays. What am I supposed to say to the teacher? You don't want to seem like, give the teachers alarm bells. Whoa, what's this kid thinking? For me, it's obvious. The answer is clear cut. There's no doubt about it. The most valuable thing in this world. One way to state it is a ticket out of this world. That's the most important thing in this world, is have a ticket out of this world. Ah, yes. Okay, there you got it. Now we know. But imagine turning an essay if you turn an essay like that, I had my teachers having conference with my parents about me. Because said the answers he's giving to, these questions, this is very odd. Never had anyone respond this way. There's something out of the ordinary. So I said, we got to do some testing, So they had tests, it was IQ. They said, oh, he's a genius. Okay, he's got a lot of potential, but, he's not using his potential. That's right. What's valuable? There's no value in this world except the ticket out of this world. Let's take it a step further. There is no value in this world except for a ticket out of this world. To a reduced intensity zone. An invitation to a reduced intensity zone. Invitation can come from those who, that's their business. They know their business. They say, hey, would you like to come to a reduced intensity zone? Sure, absolutely I would. Eager to. The teacher will say, no, we're asking what's the most important thing in this world? Well, a ticket out of this world is in this world. A ticket. Imagine if you were like in a war zone, a massacre zone, and people were looking for food, they're looking for shelter. But what if you had a ticket that got you on a plane out of the massacre zone? Like, for instance, in Vietnam, when Saigon, the southern city, that's not Saigon, is it? It's the southern city fell. I can't remember exactly the name of it, but and the U.S. compound was the only protection there was, and the North VC were storming the compound. And there were helicopters coming in, lifting key personnel off of the roof of this American embassy. And that's the only way out. They had a place surrounded. It's the only way out. And so you could imagine how a ticket to get on that helicopter, how valuable that was. People would, do anything for a ticket. For it to be chosen to say, okay, yeah, you get to get on this helicopter. They were desperate, especially all the those who had helped Americans there. I mean, the Vietnamese, South Vietnamese, were Americans were pulling out. That was it. And for them to remain there, this is like the worst possible outcome for them. So they wanted to get on the helicopter. So again, in a massacre zone, the most valuable commodity is a ticket out of there. And this world is a massacre zone. And that's going to become very apparent soon. So there you go, teacher. That's the explanation. Oh, but you're just dreaming. Everything's fine here. Really? Everything's always been fine in this world? Have you ever looked at history? I mean, the massacre zone is a moving zone. It catches up with you eventually, wherever you go. You know, if you look at the places in the world right now that are massacre zones. How could we say the world's this wonderful, benign place? And there's no massacre zones. What are you talking about? So really? So tell that to all the refugees in Europe right now. All the refugees in history. They just left everything because whimsical. There's no massacre zone here. We just felt like just leaving everything behind and fleeing in the middle of the night without anything. Just for the fun of it. Just for the heck of it. This world's a massacre zone. What if your house was blazing on fire? What would be the most valuable thing? Get out of the house, obviously. Do you start rummaging through your laundry and, I need this shirt or that. The house is blazing and smoke's everywhere. You say, hey, is there a way out of this house? And let me take that way. Right there in your mind is saying, this is what's most valuable. So what is most valuable in the world, really? What street is this? What did I do? I don't know. Okay, let me just keep going here then. It's working. Okay. What's most valuable in this world is to retain clarity about what is valuable. And this world is dedicated to confusing us about value. What has value to us? Freedom has value. What doesn't have value? Pretending that freedom doesn't exist doesn't have value to us. And this world is dedicated to confusing this issue in our minds. So what's valuable is getting out of this world, ticket out of this world, to a reduced intensity zone, not through dying, not through being massacred. We don't want to be massacred. We don't want to be part of that. We don't want to be burned with the down with the house. No. Ticket out of the house. Ticket out of the fire. Ticket out of the burning zone, the massacre zone. That's what has value. Keep reminding ourselves this, because again, this world is the notorious place, a super notorious place for confusing value in our minds. Again, this world is known as a very notorious place. And indeed it is. People need to realize that their lifestyles, all this distraction of a busy lifestyle, that is secretiveness. That's refusing to admit to the absurdist belief system that we're struggling to get free of. It is secretiveness. We think of secretiveness as people hiding, not saying anything. No, it's all this busyness is secretiveness. Talk about flipping the script. Very, very helpful. Wow. People say, I've been secretive my life. No, I've been willing to be completely open and express the absurdist nature of this world and how to get free of it. So nobody wants to listen. I would tell them, be quiet, you know, manage your success, you know, focus on contemplation and hearing and affirmations, do the path. which is quiet. You're quiet a lot of the time. That's being quiet doesn't mean you're being secretive. It means you're working on right focus, right intent, clarification, full stop in the wow, listening properly, evaluating. You may be quiet because you're at a huge wow, because you just open your mind to truth. But really, it's the constant work, going places, distraction. I got to do this. That is the secretiveness. Because it's avoiding coming clean about what they're doing. You talk about people who have bad habits and get into all sorts of troubles, and they're secretive about it and don't tell anyone. And people say, oh, I didn't know. Well, this whole world is cultivating extraordinarily bad habits, and they refuse to even admit to it or talk about it at all. That's called secretiveness. That's the secret of this. And you have to be willing to hear that and flip the script and say, oh my gosh. Wow. It's a stunner, isn't it? Yes, indeed, it is a stunner. This world is so secretive. Like if someone has a problem, a real severe problem, you know, substance abuse, some addictive problem, they don't tell anyone. They hide it. It's difficult to really get any sort of therapy going. And this world is hiding its bad habits, constantly hiding, insisting that it doesn't have any. No, I'm not involved in that. No, refusing any treatment, any therapy. Super secretive world, as if it can hide absurdity from God, as if it's separate from God, and God doesn't know. The grace of God isn't aware that we have bad habits that we need to, you know, be liberated from. So this world is like an addict. You might call us addict world. Addicted to secrecy of covering up the bad habits that it engenders. And unwilling to come clean about it at this point. In severe denial about it. Again, so this is a shock. To turn the tables, to flip the script on this one is another huge wow moment here. You know, this is something that's buried me my whole life. People claim I'm the one who's secretive. Just the opposite. Is they refuse to acknowledge you have any problems, so they say, you have nothing for me. You have nothing to tell me. You have no help for me, so be quiet. Just go and sit in your room or something. You can't help. What are you? You're crazy. I don't have any problems. They're the ones with the addiction and the secrecy problem. So in this world, there's a taboo against speaking about these bad habits here, because everybody has them. Everyone gets super uncomfortable. And, you know, is it any surprise that absurdity is adverse to truth? Is there any surprise that absurdity says, I can't do this? You know, when we say, well, this is too difficult, who is speaking for us? Absurdity doesn't speak for me. Absurdity doesn't speak for you and for anyone. Why do we let it speak for us? What, it's too difficult for truth to be true? Absurdity says, well, the path is too difficult for me. I just can't seem to succeed at this. I don't think I'm going to succeed at this. Absurdity say, I don't think I'm going to succeed in being true, you know, becoming true. No. But spirit will succeed in realizing there's no necessity to absurdity. And it hasn't changed reality in the slightest bit. Spirit will succeed at that. Now, when somebody says something shocking or something to you, don't react. Don't let your mind react in a negative way. Say, "This is the grace of God helping me out." And this is what just happened to me, is flipping the script on who is being secretive in the world, really. And people have claimed I've been so secretive. Now, I'm just trying to find some way to help people. They're so secretive, I can't even function around them. You try a million different hints. Slam the door. They're the ones slamming the door. They're the ones living behind closed doors, not me. And they tried to project that, flip it upside down, and claim I'm the one. It's horrible, this place. It really is. That's why you need to be adamantine. But, you know, these great teachers, they had vast cultural support. They really did. Most of them, okay. They were allowed to be enlightened. People realized they needed help. You go to a place where people deny they need any help at all and just try helping them out. Now, maybe I did that to try to gain some sort of merit. That is possible. Maybe the Holy Spirit was saying, no, these people, they can't be helped. But if that was the case, why would A Course in Miracles come here into the West? You know, it was supposed to help out a lot. And so, hindsight will have to resolve that one. Yeah, these people here are ultra, ultra secretive. Everyone I've met in this world is ultra secretive. I don't need any help. What are you talking about? Absurd? What do you mean absurd? I thought absurd. Okay, well, let's just look at this situation that just arose here, and let's take a careful look at it. No, what are you talking about? I don't need to look at that. Everything's fine. I got to keep moving here. I got an appointment. I'm busy. I'm too busy. Busyness is one of the greatest offenses there is. Everyone has been too busy in their life to listen to a word that I've said, anything that I've had to say, our perspective. Say, let me just point this out. Let's take a look at this. Oh, yeah, well, I'd love to. I'm too busy, but I don't need to. I mean, I'm fine. I said, oh, you're not fine because you just confused value. Got it upside down, backwards. What are you talking? Oh, I gotta go. Busy. The busyness. This is a terrible sickness. Preoccupation. I gotta fix this. I gotta make more money. I gotta fix this. Everything keeps breaking. This is part of the problem. Again, another terrible trend in the world is planned obsolescence. Everybody in a position to know about this has told me it's on purpose, so they can sell. Oh, it broke. Buy a new one. Oh yeah, we can't fix that. Throw it out. Buy a new one. So what do? You're continually struggling with having to shop, having to get new stuff, having to get used to it, having to get rid of the old stuff, having to work to get the money. And so you stay perpetually preoccupied and busy. This is an incredibly terrible trend in the world. We were just talking about how difficult it is to maintain a house and a yard and a car and everything. It is. It's horrible. If you just have a little apartment, you got public transportation, you got the markets, right? You just walk to wherever you need to go. You get boom, 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 get this, and that's it. Don't worry about the house. You have a lot more time to focus. This lifestyle here, suburban lifestyle, it's terrible as far as having to stay busy. There's always something you have to do, especially California with earthquake codes. The houses have to be built a certain way. It takes constant upkeep. You got to get a new roof every 20 years, new paint job every 10 years. You know, just continual work on your home and trying to pay for that. Always there's work in the yard. Busy, 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 busy. This is a sickness. An extreme sickness. There's reasons they built monasteries. They build them out of stone. Okay, once you get it built, it's going to last for a couple thousand years. You're not busy. What do you mean busy? Contemplate. Read this holy book. Contemplate. Meditate. Manage your success. You got plenty of time to do that. You got nothing but time here. Okay, so you realize it's either that or severe boredom. And believe me, severe boredom is not what anyone will choose. When you're faced with severe boredom, which I was faced with that one time, the boredom was so terrible, I said, I cannot live like this. I've got to get after it. Jumped into A Course in Miracles. Lifesaver. That'll keep you busy in the right way. As long as it's genuine focus. So being too house proud and yard proud and money proud and dress proud, all those things, it's a sickness. Very bad sickness. There are so many, many, many bad addictions in this world. And nobody here really wants to look at it at all. They only focus on, someone has this, alcohol, pot addiction, the drug addiction, sex addiction, various types of addictions. They only want to focus on that. And if you don't have one of those or you're managing it, you're fine. You're fine. The world says, you're fine. Nothing to worry about. Got some anxiety? Got some medications for that. Some antidepressants will put you on it. But other than that, you're fine. Don't look any deeper. How do you function in such an insane asylum? This is an insane asylum where the inmates will insist they're in charge and they insist they're perfectly okay. Except for some situations that can be treated with compounds, but other than that, they're like, no problem, they're fine. I said, but you have an absurdist belief system. It's all completely obvious. Well, so what are you talking about? You live, you're bored, you go work, then you die. What's the big deal? Well, the big deal is you come back again and do it all over again. And if you don't be liberated from absurdity, you do it again, do it all over again, you do it all over again, you do it all over again. And every time absurdity says, no, this is different, this is different, this is different. No, you're not an absurdity anymore, this is a different life. Different sicknesses, different, everything's different, you got to make it different. And it tells you, it's up to you to make absurdity, to learn how to be happy with absurdity. Absurdity says you're evolving. And you're learning how to be happy with absurdity within an absurdist context. And so then you have it. I didn't quite make it. The next life you'll make it. Another life and another life. And he goes on and on and on and on and on and on and on like that. And eventually you start saying, hey, I feel like I'm stuck on a treadmill here of suffering. There seems to be no way out. Then you start falling into some more obvious addictions, maybe. So I got trouble. I just feel despondent. This is hideous. I can't stand existence. This is horrible. And people say, well, we got medications for that. What are you talking about? You don't like the world? Oh, come on. You're just not trying hard enough. Everybody's got the same issues. Come on, you're not trying hard. Well, really? Maybe somebody's had like 10 lives and I'm working on my 100th one or something, right? And after so many lives, you start realizing, hey, I'm being lied to. I've been lied to every step of the way. They said, this is my last one. This is different. No, same suffering. You start to put some pieces together after a while. You suffer long enough, you start asking some tougher questions is what happens. You start asking those tougher questions, you start feeling more and more dismayed. Like, what is really going on here? Is this insanity? And those who are not yet asking those questions, of course they say, well, I'm just a slave here. I'll just put in my time here and I might die. I'm finished, so why should I ask questions? So we're not all equal in that way at all. The ones who start asking the tough questions, they realize, wow, I need some answers here. I'm not getting the answers I need. They're in a very different boat. We're not all in the same boat in a pragmatic sense at all. In an absolute sense, we're all in the same boat. We all need to get free of absurdity. Drop it. Yeah, sure, that way. But pragmatically, there are those who feel the teeth of absurdity a lot more than others because they've been around, gone around and around and around and around, and around so many times. They say, I'm tired of this. I'm just fed up with it. I am absolutely fed up with it. And then they start asking, help, I need some help, what's going on here? And so they're in a pragmatically a different boat, very different boat. Cannot equate the two. And civilization insists on equating the two, so it's all the same. Just don't make waves. Stop asking these questions. Be like everybody else. That's like somebody's been in kindergarten and they get held back every year and there's all these newbies are coming in the first time of kindergarten and they've been in kindergarten for 10 years. And they say, hey, you know, I've been through this before. I want to move on from this. And I say, what are you talking about? You're just not able to fit in, huh? No, this is your first time here. I say, no, it all seems very familiar to me. I think I've been in kindergarten before. What are you talking about? Fit in here. You're just not having problems. Adjust. Don't worry, we have some medications. We have some compounds that'll help you adjust. You just have adjustment problems. No, I don't think that's it. This feels like it's very familiar to me. Like I've been done this over at Groundhog Day. I've done it over and over and over and over and over. It doesn't seem right. Well, you're suffering from some sort of mental illness then. Right? So is this happy with this? Happy with this world? The belief system of this world? How about that ticket to a reduced intensity zone? It's looking a little more valuable, isn't it? So we're expected here to adjust to absurdity. Our lack of happiness is because we haven't learned how to adjust to absurdity, as if we can adjust to it and be happy with it. This is the burden that is placed upon us here, that absurdity places upon us. It's a burden. We cannot adjust to absurdity. We are truth itself. We are freedom itself. How can we, freedom itself, adjust to pretending that freedom doesn't exist and then feel that they're content with that? Only perfect freedom brings contentment to us because we are that. We cannot be content denying what we are. Pretending that what we are doesn't exist. And absurdity claims that's what we have to do. And that we're maladjusted if we can't do it. And all those who are hiding all their addictions, that they're well adjusted. They're not well adjusted. As Jesus said, all death is suicide. Now, did these like Dzogchen masters, did they really die? Apparently not. They just translate their body into clear light. Is that death? Not really. Really die? Not really. He just had an appearance of dying, but then he showed everyone, no, look, it's just mere appearance. It was just mere appearance, folks. I didn't really die. All death is suicide. That's straight from Jesus. All death is suicide. All of it. God did not create death. God's not causing anything to die. We're pretending to die. All death is pretense, is what it is. So how can pretense be the end of pretense? We pretend to die. How can pretending to die be the end of death? It's never there in the first place. How can we get rid of something it's not real? We have to stop pretending is the only solution to it. So my prayer, more and more adamant teaching. This is what I want. This is what I'm accustomed to. Nothing less than this is what I expect. So I am gung-ho for more and more miracles here. Let's get the great teachers on the ground and run, you know, get their boots on the ground here. And let's get some adamant teaching, more adamant teaching, please. More cowbell, come on. More adamant teaching. It's like beautiful music. Way better than beautiful music. Are you kidding me? Would I rather listen to this or some Bach, you know, organ fugue or something? I'd rather listen to this. I've already done all my listening to music. Massive amount of listening to music. I was a musicaholic. Musaholic. Also, you know, listening to the muse, a musaholic. I was a severe musaholic. You talk about an addiction. That's one of the worst. For sure it's one of the worst. A musaholic. I'm a recovering musaholic. I actually listened to something just last night. Again, it's hard, you know, musaholic's like, oh, let me just have a little sip. Listen to some Blondie. First I listened to the Rolling Stones, can't Satisfaction, you know. Mick Jagger, let me tell you, he's a weird dude. You know, looking at his actions and everything, very frenetic. Not a good influence in my opinion. Okay. The body language, he likes to get people in a frenzy. Yeah, it's just, wow. I said, wow. No. Very charismatic front man, but if you just look carefully at his movements, and you see the way he's moving and stuff, he's trying to agitate. You know, he's driving us into the reptilian mind, reptilian part of the brain, so to speak. Very much a reptilian type of entity, Mick Jagger. Wow. That I ultimately found my way to Blondie, which the more I listen to Blondie, the more I feel that they're one of the best bands of all time, if not the top band. I mean, wow. When you talk about a rock band, I mean, the Deborah Harry singing has got this New York edge to it. You know, well, I don't know if it's, maybe it's a Jersey girl or something, but it's this edge to the voice, very edgy. And guttural, and it's very rock. It's got a great rock voice there, and the musicality and the lyrics and everything. I mean, it's just top notch. Blondie was absolutely top notch. One of the greatest bands ever, if not the best. I don't know who you would say is better. I mean, because it was very smoothed out, very sophisticated, smoothed out, and yet this really cool edge to it. I spoke yesterday of many amazing things that happened. And one of them was this man walking with a backpack and a sleeping bag and it rolled up in such a way that you could stick something through the center of the roll. And he had this long wooden staff and he was carrying, the staff was over his shoulder and the sleeping bag was stuck like a marshmallow kind of through this wooden staff. It was resting on his shoulder and he was walking along. I said, this is a homeless man, this is a wanderer. But he was dressed real sharply. I think he had a beard, but it was nicely, I mean, I said, this guy, his shoes were shiny, nice boots. I said, this guy, what's going on here? This is very odd. I've never seen a homeless man look like this. I went home, there's this card I found, I just found it lying in the ground. I picked it up. It's St. Jude, this card. Famous Christian saint. Very famous. The patron saint of lost causes, hopeless causes. The saint of last resort. Very powerful saint in Christianity. I've prayed to St. Jude before, absolutely. So I stuck this holy card, it was a holy card, near the computer. I could see it. So I get home and I look at this holy card and I said, my gosh, the man that I saw there looks very similar to St. Jude. And the picture with the long wooden staff, he had the same long wooden staff as St. Jude. I said, okay. Then I'm told that, did you know that St. Jude's day is Thursday? This was told to me. Thursday. I said, oh, I didn't know that. Oh, yeah, pray every Thursday's prayers to St. Jude. What day did this man appear there walking along the street? Thursday. It was Thursday. And I said, you know, I wonder if the saints are reappearing in this world. For a saint to appear in this world is easy. They can just appear any appearance they want. I know Jesus is back. Been back for almost a year now. I wonder if the saints from all different traditions are back in this world now to help us out with this extreme crisis emergency where absurdity is trying to go for a coup and wants to confuse us so badly that we can't discern the difference between absurdity and truth. Or at least it becomes so difficult that absurdity will claim we don't have any capacity to do so, and then it will claim, but don't worry, you're okay because there is no truth. Absurdity is truth, so you're fine. Nothing needs to be treated. Happy days are here again, right? This is absurdity. Are the saints starting to appear in this world? This is a possibility here, I'm saying, and this angelic visitation of this Dakini, which I am looking at, there's a very strong possibility that this great Dakini Chandra Tessering showed up, appeared here. That's a Tibetan saint, and you would say it's a Tibetan saint, very highly revered in Tibetan Buddhist tradition. Well, it wouldn't be surprising, because the crisis is now in this world. The crisis is now. This is the mega crisis that's coming, a convergence of many crises, which are simply empowerments of absurdity, attempting to empower itself, trying to bring them all together, to give this super empowerment to absurdity. This is the times we live in. This is the times that Jesus warned us about. He said he would come back at those times to help us out. Well, he's back. Why wouldn't he come back with his saints? Of course he would. Saint Jude is a great saint. Saint Jude is known to have given a tremendous number of miracles to those who pray for help from him. So let's all pray to Saint Jude. Because this is certainly, from one standpoint, this is seems like a hopeless cause, what's going on in the world. This is a hopeless situation. We are in dire danger here of being convinced that, you know, a ticket out of here has no value. That's the last thing you want to have happen. Uh-oh, I forgot my phone. That's not good. Oh, I knew I forgot something. So maybe, can I go over here? Yeah, I better go back and get that phone. Better go back and get that photo. Oh my gosh. Disaster. Okay, well, what can I do? You can't go anywhere these days without your phone, right? It's against the law, I think. Oh. Okay, so I said, well, I'm going to get in big trouble if I don't take my phone. Why don't you take your phone? What are you doing? Leave your phone. Why? You know, wow. Shoot. Oh, well. All is good. Saints are coming back. Let's pray for all saints to come back now and help us out at this supreme crisis now in the world. Supreme crisis. The inability to discern value from no value, truth from lies, that is a supreme crisis. This is what the aim of absurdity is. That's what its aim is. that it feels very confident that it can achieve this aim. The ego is very confident right now. And that's why he's telling everybody, don't worry, you know, everything is going to get better in a hurry here. The millennium, peace, prosperity, happiness. Getting everybody, promising everybody, it's fine, it's going to be fine here, everything's going to be great here. Let's see who shows up next. Let's see what shows up next. Now, the play of the Holy Spirit is virtually inscrutable. And so you have to have faith that there is a play of grace taking place. All right? You cannot let scientists lead the way in this world. You cannot. Unless they're, you know, a truly, truly objective scientists who certainly believe in miracles, realize that miracles do happen. So faith, this essential faith, is that there is a play of God's grace taking place in our lives. And it's beyond the scope of what we can clearly recognize. We can see some of it. We can recognize, you know, this and that, but the Holy Spirit is orchestrating everything, the play of grace. We must have faith in that. Otherwise, we are going to, absurdity is going to grab a hold of us. It really will. And that'll tell us, don't worry. I'm stressed out. Don't worry. Here's some drugs. And then that makes it even more difficult to discern between truth and lies. So let our intention right now be, invite all the saints back. All saints are welcome here, from all traditions, call it what you like. All welcome right here, right now. This very instant. Let the world be flooded with the play of grace we call God's saints. Let the world be flooded with them. Let them be everywhere. Now they can be many places at once, actually. Just mere appearance. The mind can project appearance really endless places, actually. There's no limit to it, really. So, yeah, the world can be flooded with saints. Absolutely, it can. People can begin experiencing this all over the place. I expect to. I absolutely expect to. This is my expectation. And we say, oh, thank you. Nice, wonderful to make your acquaintance. I'm just super, super thrilled that you're here. Super thrilled that you're here. And I look forward to full awareness of the one family that we're all inseparably part of, the family of spiritual perfection, inherent spiritual perfection. You must have this daring mindset right now. Daring mindset dares to meet with saints now. Meet up with saints. Absolutely. This must occur. Put this in your mind. This is what I expect. Now, you don't expect to see the heavyweights necessary first off, okay? That would be too much for us, really. I mean, I would love to, but it might be too much wow. So, you know, you start out with the Chandra Tessering. Tessering, T-S-E-R, Tessering. That's a Tressering, Chandra Tressering. And a St. Jude. And you start out, these are, you know, great, but you know, the super heavyweights, it might be too much wow for us. Yeah. Something like that. We work our way up. We work our way up. We get more, we get used to it. Get used to it. I've been looking for the fifth boost. Had four big boosts, and I've been looking for the fifth boost. Maybe this is the fifth boost. It's the return of the saints here. The reappearance of the saints will be the fifth boost. Boost us into a reduced intensity zone. So have your attention that you become aware of what's going on, aware of this. Keep in mind that the ways of God's grace are beyond the scrutiny of the absurdist belief system, and very much beyond the scrutiny of it. Absurdity just simply chases its tail. That's all. Everything is a mere appearance. It's light. It's just a mere appearance of light. No such thing as time, space, process, and form, actually. That's just a pretensional conformity. I mean, conforming to pretension, how is that a law, a rule, a reality? Someone walks down the street with a limp. Everybody else decides to walk down the street with a limp. Does that mean that there's an actual crippledness? Is that true? No. It's that everyone's pretending. So how is it that if everyone's pretending, how does that make this pretense real? In what kind of belief system, logic, could that make pretense real? The very fact that we're pretending means we're not that way. Pretending means I'm limping, but actually I'm just faking it. I'm not actually damaged at all. So we're pretending not to be perfect, not to be free. It's pretension. So how is it that if everyone, so many of us are pretending together, that somehow that makes it fact? Reality fact. How could that be? How can that be? The answer is it's not. It's not true. So the saints are just simply realize that it's pretension. They're not bound by pretension. They can appear here and disappear. They can appear there and then disappear. There's no time, space, process, and form in mind. If they want to pretend to have an appearance here, if they want to project an appearance, they know it's just an appearance. A useful teaching aid, perhaps, for us. Helpful, okay. They're not bound by it. They don't say, oh, I'm a body walking this world. I have to age and die. I can't go anywhere. No, they say, okay, I've helped someone out. Okay, time to disappear. No more appearance. I need to appear somewhere else. I'll appear somewhere else. I need to appear here and there, no problem. And then I'll disappear. The appearance no longer is needed. Projection, all mental projection, all of this. I don't think they taught this in school, did they? I have to put it in somewhat oblique terms here, not to draw a line of inference to anyone, except, let's just say someone told me a story who was inside, very much inside information. Extremely so. Someone with a lot of authority and power. He told me what it's like inside, let's say, one of the most prestigious learning institutions in the world. And what really goes on there. And the crimes, and the cover-ups, and the attitudes, and wow. This is coming from someone who take it from the horse's mouth. Super critical of it. It's, you know, you talk about entitlement complexes. They think that what they say is gospel to you, to the world. And they're super materialists. Okay. They expect you to bow down and touch the ground they walk upon, whatever they say. But really, they're just some back swamp rednecks with apologies to the back swamp rednecks. They're just living in some backwater. I mean, they're way down. They think they're the highest echelon, and they're not even in the echelonness. Not even in the echelons, really. Just serving absurdity. Serving absurdity is no... You cannot talk about echelons when you're serving absurdity. Okay? You're not even started there. And yet they think they're just the baddest thing in the world. You know, we are the light unto the world. Wow. Traffic. What do you expect here? I mean, it's always like, oh, no. You get onto the freeway and you look and say, oh, no. Every time. Uh-oh. I thought I was going to get somewhere on time. Uh-oh. Maybe not. You know, going like Sunday morning, and the morning is nice. There's nobody on the freeways. Just like, oh, isn't this nice? I have the freeway to myself. It's beautiful. Are you ready? Are you ready? Are you ready for that judgment day? Yep. What's judgment day? Well, just judge that the absurdity will never be true. And then only truth will ever be true. Only truth will ever be true. Absurdity will never be true. That's the judgment we need to make. And if we can, you know, most of this world can't make that judgment. They cannot make that judgment. Can't make it. This is the influence of what we call the devil. I mean, the adversary, the ego. Its job is to confuse our minds. Do we not understand this? After thousands and thousands of years here and great, great teachers, do we still not understand that the adversary, the way that it functions, is to confuse our minds? So we feel scared to make a differentiation between truth and lies. And the absurdity says, that's discrimination. You're discriminating against lies. Prejudiced, intolerant, bigoted against lies. So, you know, we're intimidated. So that's the adversary that is talked about in great spiritual traditions. The adversary tries to confuse our mind. And this is, of course, just the functioning of an absurdist belief system, which is the product, effect of our desire to be greater than God. And the way to do it, the only way to do it, is to change reality. And so it's a reflection of our desire to change reality. And reality can't be changed, so it's merely this absurdist belief system. It's all that it is. It's all that will ever be. So I left a little early and had to go back and get my phone. I'm officially official. I don't think you exist if you don't have a phone, right? People try to call. I can't call you. You must have disappeared. You don't exist. What's going on? What is going on with this world? This is just wimps. Say, yeah, but we're absurdist wimps. Absurdity's gonna win. Absurdity's gonna win. That's what they're saying. Absurdity. Well, we may look bad now, but when absurdity wins, you'll see. You'll find out then. What else can they say? What else can absurdity say? But we call upon the power, all power now. That which is empowered right now. We call upon that. Thank you. that which needs no other moment to have power, to be powerful and knowledgeable. That which needs no time in order to be what it is. We call upon that. Instead of accepting a hospital bed, crawling into a hospital bed and being hooked up to all these machines, if they could, oh, finally I'm safe, finally I'm secure. Just, all these blinking machines and IVs and tubes I'm hooked up to, oh, wow, this is the nirvana that absurdity offers us. And then they send you home, and sick still. I mean, yeah, that's Volkswagen TDI. Oh yeah, we got this new diesel injection engine that's like a super, super great all-time engineering breakthrough. The engineers at Volkswagen have engineered this revolutionary breakthrough new engine that has super low sulfur, low emissions. Super low emissions. It gets super great mileage. And we have, vaulted into the 21st century plus with clean energy. I mean, we are this is a major, mega breakthrough in clean energy. The TDI, whatever they call it. And then they find out it was all just pie-in-the-sky marketing. There was no such engine existed. Sold all these cars. Built up their brand like we're the greatest thing since sliced bread. And then, guess what? It was just all just kind of, it was a marketing mistake, some overzealous people in the marketing department. Said that we got these great edges. We don't really have these great edges. In fact, they don't even pass the environmental standards test at all. Yeah. Other than that, they're good engines, though. Oh, well, it's marketing snafu. I don't know what happened. I got it. So some wires got crossed here. Welcome to the New World Order. Oh, man. What? Ooh. But we're on the lookout for saints. Just in our prayers. We're not staring at everybody who walks past like, oh, baby, that's... No, it just in our prayers and our expectations, we just... We allow for that. We allow it. We allow it in our lives. You have to allow it in your lives. Nothing happens in your life unless you allow it to happen. This is a fundamental fact of reality. And you're experiencing. Nothing happens in our experiencing, anyone's experiencing, that they don't allow and desire to have happen. Without a single exception. Not for age, not for gender, not for any reason. No exceptions to this. interesting. So we have to allow it to happen in our lives. Be willing to have this happen in our lives. I'm trying my best to be willing. We'll see how it goes. I don't want to, let's not count our chickens before they're hatched. Let's settle for the saints we get. The saints we get are the ones that we're willing to settle for. Any saint is a big wow. Very big wow. And they help get us ready for the Hall of Famers. Whose fearlessness and compassion has absolutely no limit to it. It's just complete, full-on familiarity and acceptance. And Hall of Famers, top echelon Hall of Famers. Well, we'll let that happen when it happens. Meanwhile, let's keep taking care of business here. Not want our minds to become confused. I'm not watching politics, I'm not following this, I'm not following that, because all this stuff is designed to draw you in like a spider's web. And at some point, and it always functions this way, something goes wrong, something happens. And it's designed to be great entertainment. People tell me, it's just so entertaining to watch all this rat race, right? So entertaining. Well, not really. It's so engrossing is what it is. And the engrossment, it's kind of like a beautiful spider in a spider web with all these colorful patterns, and the insects say, oh, it looks like a flower or something. I'm going to go investigate. It's so interesting. And, oops, I didn't see the web. What's this? I feel kind of stuck. Let me struggle here. Oops, I got more stuck. Let me struggle some more. So it's important to not struggle. Do not struggle. If you feel stuck, don't struggle. Call upon the Holy Spirit with faith and ask the Holy Spirit to flip the script for you, which it will do. And then you get a different perspective and you say, oh, gee, Webb. Looks like you're stuck on me, huh? Let me help you get unstuck on me. It's not, oh, I'm stuck on this web. It's got hold of me. I said, no. Oh, gee, what a pity. I see you have some trouble here with your web. It seems to have stuck here on me. So let me help your web out here and free the web up from me. So it's not stuck on me anymore. Oh, there, good. Now the web should be fine. Flip the script 100%. Flip it. I'm not stuck on the web. The web's stuck on me. So I'm totally empowered. I don't have to struggle. Let me just get it unstuck here, and everything's fine. Don't struggle. That's why we sit quietly with poise, refusing to struggle. I will not struggle physically. I will not struggle emotionally. I will not struggle mentally. I will remain poised and confident, full of faith in the grace of God. And in truth, I will not struggle. Have a wonderful destiny to look forward to. Meeting the saints, getting reacquainted with with the saints, acquainted or reacquainted. This is what we have to look forward to. Those who, the Denisians of the reduced intensity zones, could very well be showing up here. Or especially the teachers of those zones could be very well showing up here to shepherd us into those zones. They call Jesus the Good Shepherd. He shepherds us into those zones, those higher reduced intensity zones. So may the good shepherd's work be unobstructed, entirely unobstructed, and entirely fruitful, without any exception whatsoever. Right now, let this fruitfulness be here now. Are you ready? Are you ready? Are you ready for that judgment day? Shepherding, let us be shepherded in. Stopped on the freeway. This isn't good. Rush hour traffic. Everybody wants to get out of Dodge here. It is what it is. Well, what can I do? Not much. Everything will be fine. Breaks, just ease off a little bit. Again, the more intensity we are able to be accustomed to, the easier it is, easier it becomes for us, and then we can handle even more. This is the secret. Everyday work intensity. Everyday intensity is the great secret. Everyday intensity. So we're just getting used to this new level of intensity here. Talking about the return of the saints. Play of God's grace. And what's going to show up next? Get up in the morning and say, okay, another day. Another saint. And let that be like normal for us. Another day, another saint. I like that. Another day, another saint. Meet one saint a day. Let's have our goal. Let's meet one saint every day. It's a lot of saints to meet, actually. And each one of them has a boost for us. There's more saints than we know. The absurdity isn't really into... You know, making it clear how many saints there are. That's not his thing, really. Well, a lot of people, if I ask these people on the road right now, I'd like you to name me as many saints as you can. Give me the name of, let's start with one saint. Give me the name of that one saint. Okay, now give me the name of another one. Yeah. How many could they name? Well, it might be a lot of people couldn't name even one saint. Can you believe this? Maybe go man, you know, man on the street interviewing. Asking questions. Give me the name of one saint. Saint. What do you mean by saint? I don't know. I mean, I don't really believe in saints. So I'm not really sure what to say. Okay, let me ask someone else. Give me a name of one saint. One saint? I don't know. I don't really know. Can't help you there. Okay, thank you very much. Give me the name of one saint. And some maybe a Catholic go, Saint Peter. There, you go. There's one. Okay. And I'll give you the name of another one. Oh, boy. A little rusty on this. Huh. So we don't, the absurdity doesn't want to be called out like this. It doesn't want people to realize, say, wait a minute, you know, how come I can't think of any saints? Is that, am I leading a good life? Is this the kind of life I lead where I don't even, I'm not even aware of any saints? Is that the kind of life that I really want here? Is that a good life? I seem to be forgetting. Maybe I've become more forgetful. I mean, why have I been forgetting? Is there something that is helping me forget? Something encouraging me to forget? And they start asking these questions. And absurdity says, whoa, not so fast. Let's not ask these questions. Let's not get into it. Go back to sleep. Are you ready? Oh. My load. I got 7 women on my mind. 3 who wanna stone me, 3 who wanna own me, 1, well, she's a friend of mine. Take it easy, take it easy. Don't let the sound of your own wheels drive you crazy. Lighten up while we still can. Don't even try to understand. Yeah. Da 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 da, and take it easy. Don't even try to understand, right? Don't stay in the wow of it. Stay in the wow of it. Stay in the wow of it. Lighten up while you still can. Lighten up while you still can. The aspects of this world. You know, the 3 aspects want to stone me, 3 want to own me. Those are the crisis trends of the world. Crisis trends of the world. But we do have 1 friend, you know, which was the grace of God, actually. Lighten up while you still can. Lighten up while you still can. Now, we were going into this plague in the 60s, the 70s. We were going into the severe plague. Mental plague. We're saying, oh no, this is horrible. Going into a stormy seas. Excessive waves of the severe plague, and it's just going to get worse and peak. We've just seen the medium sets, small to medium sets of waves, and now the big ones are coming. Lighten up while you still can. Don't even try to understand. Just make a something and take your stand or something, and take it easy. It's been a while. That's been a while. How many years has that been? Maybe 40 years or something? I mean, what? Years of storminess here. The freeway is moving well right now. It has recaptured its speed, it's mojo. Lighten up while you still can. So this is a very good outlook for us. Before, before we get so confused that we can't tell the difference. We're not sure which way was light is lightening up is. So may all saints appear immediately. Full on immediate flooding of the world with all the great saints, sages, every label you want to apply to them. All the effective ones. May all the effective ones. May all those who are effective in liberating us from absurdity, the absurdist belief system, may they all flood the world. And may they walk with us and talk with us and counsel us and encourage us and help us. Some kind of spiritual mentoring program here. May there be this awesome spiritual mentoring program come upon the world right now. May we listen to them and heed their advice. And get this going. Get it going. Get this true exodus going. Exodus to the promised land. Well, the promised pure lands, the reduced intensity zones. Let's get this exodus underway. Maybe one way to listen to these videos, they're rather long, is to just, you know, click somewhere in the video, click somewhere along the time track and just tune in like that. Let me tune in here, let me tune in there, let me tune in here, and everywhere you tune in, you're going to get something. We're not worried about a linear situation here. So I bop in and I bop out, and I keep trying to bring the best inspiration of the day here. And keep in mind that these are the most relevant times we've ever had here. This is when we can expect mega miracles, just like we can expect mega crisis to happen. Mega crisis, flip side, mega miracles. To have a mega crisis without and not avail ourselves of mega miracles, wow, that's not good at all. Don't want that option. Let's just move that option off to the side there and say, no, that's not what I'm going looking for. And don't say, no, well, it's just, you know, let's see, oh, let's try to prevent the mega crisis coming. Prevent. You know, well, how about just have the miracles anyway? Which is all good. And if that there's no mega crisis, it's still all good. And, of course, the best way to prevent a mega crisis is to turn towards miracles. So don't say, no, we don't need miracles. Let's just work on trying to prevent this crisis, then we won't need miracles. Well, what is that? That's absurdity, isn't it? All miracles do is collapse time and thereby evaporate delay. That's all they do, ultimately. So how can they be bad? It's all good. It's all good. Do you listen to your wheels? I sure don't. I'm listening right now. I just thought, wheels? What wheels? maneuver. Now, imagine if you were listening to your wheels as you drove. Don't do that. It's just, okay, just let the wheels do their thing. Don't let the internal noise of the body, the clickety-clackness of the body, don't listen to that. Put everything into a future life. If all troubles in a future life, I'll have a life of full of troubles at some point, if I choose to. It's an option I have. Of course, we could at any point, we can decide, nah, this time I don't want to have troubles. I'll put it in the future one. If I decide. So, of course, by doing this, we can get familiar with bliss right now. And what does that do? Overcomes the continuity problem, which is what is the only problem we have. And then we're in a much better spot to discern, decide, do I really want another life or not? Pass all superficiality. Was that Dave Dudley or something like that? King of the Trucker songs. Trucker singers, yeah. Off the freeway. Just like that. Somehow my mirror, side mirror on the driver's side, somehow got moved. So I didn't see this car. I started to go over it and I stopped. I looked a little bit, but it wasn't immediately apparent in the mirror, which is not good. So sometimes our mirrors get moved, actually. And so, you know, I'm always checking the mirrors to make sure they're right, but sometimes they get a little off for some reason. And that's important. It's important. Mirrors are like clarity. You want to have clarity when you're driving. You ought to be able to ascertain quickly, you know, what's going on. What's really trending here? Well, it's absurdity that's trending here. It's always absurdity trending. It's either absurdity or salvation, but the only alternative to truth is to deny truth, pretend that truth doesn't exist, and that's absurdity. Minnesota, land of 10,000 lakes. That's a lot of lakes if you think about it. 10,000 lakes. That'd be too many lakes. There's a nice techie behind me with a dash cam mounted just beneath their rear view mirror, making sure it records everything that happens. That's a sign. Hundreds of townhouses proposed for this site. There's a nice grassy, beautiful grassy field here. and they're going to stick up hundreds of townhouses. They're able to jam these townhouses in, like, 10 per lot, per acre. You know, this is what they're able to do. I'm, what? Why?